Yeah, thank you. We've talked yesterday a lot about local transport systems and local transport networks, and more particularly we have seen some interesting applications on how network analysis can be applied on our networks. To tell us more about how these transport networks actually worked. But today I want to talk about the validity of these network analysis applications on research on transport networks, and by extension the validity of the archaeological interpretation thereof. So as Philip said, everything that I will present today was done in the context of a project called Finding the Limits of the Limits, which focuses on the cultural landscape of the Dutch part of the Roman Limes, and more particularly the spatial relations between the rural population and the Roman military population. And what I will present today focuses around a case study in the modern city of Utrecht. And I will focus chronologically on the Middle Roman period, so that's roughly between 70 and 200 AD. Now, what do we actually know about transport? Most of what we know about transport in our area relates to that which occurred on the regional to the imperial scale, such as the physical and historical evidence that we have for the road road networks, such as the Tabula Peutingeriana, which most of you might know. But we have very little evidence for local transport, and this is enhanced by the fact that most local transport probably occurred along mere routes rather than actually archaeological visible roads. So some of the questions that we then want to know is, how was transport coming from the local population to the Roman army population organized? And also, what is the role of individual settlements within these transport network? Now, this is the main dataset that I'm going to be showing today. I've actually talked about this last year at CAA and the Landscape Archaeology Conference, so I'm not going to go into too much detail because you can all read it there in an open access article as well. I'll just briefly introduce you to the main elements of our dataset. We have a number of sites, mostly consisting of small rural settlements. There are a small number of stone-built settlements, indicated by the dark blue colors, and then a number of military sites, which are mostly located along the Rhine itself. And then least cost paths were constructed between these sites, taking into account the natural environment. And the natural environment in this case consists of the floodplains in green, the natural levees in orange colors, and the peatlands in brown colors. And this least cost path network was then transformed into an actual network on which we could apply network analysis. And one particular measure that I'm going to talk about today is between centrality, which was already introduced yesterday, but I'll just shortly repeat for you, that it's a local network measure that calculates how many shortest paths between all pairs of other nodes must pass through the node considered. Now, this is an example of the application of between centrality, and you can already see some interesting results, such as a number of important sites appearing on so-called bottleneck locations. So they have a strategic position in the landscape that allows them to command movements within a network. Another interesting aspect are the I can use the pointer, by the way. Are the dark blue, which, if you remember, are the stone-built settlements. Even though they are a minority in our total site assemblage, they consistently appear as important sites in the network. So maybe these relatively richer settlements have become rich because they are associated in transport networks. Applying network analysis on our research on transport networks shows some promising results, but we have some reservations about the application of network analysis. Perhaps these results are only valid for this particular structure or particular network that that's being analyzed, and the results could potentially change due to small variations in the network, such as sites missing from our dataset, or incorrect dating of sites, incorrect interpretation of sites, or perhaps uncertainty in our least cost path reconstruction, for instance, related to our uncertainty in the paleogeography that we have of the area. So the goal of this paper is to test the robustness and thus the validity of our network analysis results in hopes of getting more grips on how valid our actual archaeological interpretations are. I've done this experiment in NetLogo, but it could of course be done in any programming language. I will just start a video to show you how it works, if I can get it to work. So I hope it works. The network starts with one site, and then subsequently new sites are being added from the pre-existing dataset with all associated connections, and then it recalculates the between centrality at each step. And you can see the development of between centrality here. And what we're interested in is to see how this developed and if there's some sort of stabilization of these results. This is the typical output of such a simulation. You can see the development of between centrality here, and I've done this for each site, and not only one time, but I've done this 100 times for each site, so that you can get the variation that there is, of course, in this sort of random simulation. But more interesting, what I'm also looking at is the betweeners rank, and I define this as the relative importance of a site in relation, of course, to the other sites. You can split this in absolute betweeners rank. So, for instance, this site has an absolute betweeners rank of about 25. But what I'm mostly interested in is then the percentage betweeners rank. Which is then at the end of around 242 sites, it's about, looks like 12%. So it's particularly the stabilization of this measurement, the percentage betweeners rank, that I'm interested in, because it tells us something about the stabilization of the role that the site has within the network itself. Now, the results for each site I've divided into a limited number of graph types based on a few indicators, namely the convex break in the percentage between this rank, the stabilization of the rank, and the timing of this stabilization. And the first type that I've shown here is I've defined as type A1, which is characterized by an early rise in the percentage between this rank, a visible convex break here, and a very early stabilization, stabilizes around here, of the percentage between this rank. Now we also have a type A2, A3, and A4, but they are very similar, only different in terms of the timing of the stabilization. So you have middle stabilization until very late stabilization of the percentage between this rank. What we can deduce from this is that for type A, we can say that between the centrality is a robust measurement because percentage between this rank stabilizes before the entire network is present. So it's not susceptible to minor variations in the present network. And between centrality, we can just say, from an archaeological point of view, is an inherent property of the site's location and the site's role within transport networks. So the robustness of the between centrality also adds robustness to our archaeological interpretations. Now we also have other types, of course. This is type B, which is characterized again by a small, well, not very visible here, but convex break. But there's no stabilization in the percentage between this rank, but there is some sort of a trend of leveling off towards stabilization. Now I've interpreted this as meaning that between centrality is perhaps partly inherent, but the site's location is not wholly determined by the site's role in transport networks. So maybe they could occupy a strategic position in the landscape, but maybe peripheral in terms of the network itself. Type C again is then very different, which it has a concave declining percentage between this rank, an increasing absolute between this rank, and absolutely no stabilization of the network measures. Now, this shows that between centrality for this for sites belonging to this type is not robust and is very dependent on that precise network structure being present. And from an archaeological point of view, we can say perhaps that the site location is not governed by a strategic position in transport networks. Now, this is another type, which is different in that this has a complex increasing percentage between his rank and a declining absolute between his rank, and again no stabilization of the two. And again, as for type C, this shows that between centrality for this type is not robust. Is also the location is not governed by the strategic position in transport networks, but more interestingly, this type seems to appear among sites that are along the edges of our network. So this type could potentially be used to identify edge effects in our transport network research. Now, this is a very particular type, which is characterized by zero between the centrality. And this, of course, shows sites that are either disconnected or have very few connections to other sites in the network that are not traveled as shortest path. So they have no role in transport networks. Now, we've done this for various modes of transportation that we look at in our research. We have here in the horizontal roads, regular walking while carrying heavy loads, ox cart transport and mule cart transport. And you can see that for the regular walking and the mule cart transport, type A is much more prevalent. And this is related to the way of traveling, because in the regular walking and mule cart transport, they are both relatively faster and easier modes of transportation, so they have more connections in the network, and thus the centrality measures are more robust, because by extension a completely connected network will have a perfectly robust network measurements. Now, if we look at all 242 sites in all four transport networks, a total of 64% of our sites have a robust between the centrality, so they belong to one of these four type A groups. Now, if we look at the first decile in terms of between the between the rank, so those are the 24 most important sites, then even up to 81% of sites have a robust between the centrality. And if we look at types A2 and A3, they are much more prevalent in the first few deciles, and even significantly more abundant, indicated by an asterisk here in some of them. And other interesting things to note is that type C is more prevalent in the top half, and type D is more prevalent in the lower deciles. So this tells us something about the distribution of our types among the sites themselves. Now, to conclude, so what I've shown is that 64% of sites in our transport network have a robust between the centrality. So this also adds validity to the archaeological interpretation, because they are not entirely dependent on that precise network structure being present, but they would still be the same if there are minor variations due to sites perhaps missing from the data sites or sites being falsely present in our data set. However, we have to take into account that 36% of sites are thus don't have a robust between the centrality, and thus we cannot be certain about their archaeological interpretation of the network analysis results. And thus I want to conclude that measuring the robustness of our network measurements is necessary to validate our archaeological interpretations. So that was it. Thank you.